mentioned that, but that might have been a risk that we would have announced at that time anyway.
Through you, Chair. In the trial case between the fire officers and the judges, is that because the fire officers now having retired, which has been 30 years service, are able to work longer to that time frame? So would it be reasonable to assume that every local authority within the trial case impacts on producing their accounts, that all local authorities will be in the same position as us, or that are there any other mitigating factors where we are perhaps one of only a few to not produce the accounts in a timely fashion?
Yeah, thank you. Yes, through you, Chair. Yes, so that does impact on all public sector organisations, so not just local authorities, police, fire, NHS as well. Some authorities, I'm not calling for all local authorities, I was at catching up with my colleagues 2 weeks ago at the CIPA conference. The general feeling was that this would impact on whether their local authorities would be able to get their accounts on in time and audit in time. Some were feeling that they might be able to do it depending on the capacity of their external audit as well, because different external audit companies audit differently around the country, so they don't have more capacity to be able to do it. Some colleagues that I've spoken to from across the country said that they wouldn't be able to have their accounts finalised on time, and they were looking at different arrangements as to what they could do, so they wouldn't be finalised on the 30th day. So I think it differs across the accounts, local authorities across the country.
Top. Thanks, Sharon. Just following on from Cathy's question about capacity, please do correct me if I'm wrong, but it sounds to me that our accounting systems are quite old and quite antiquated. That doing a single or a couple of transactions is quite long, quite convoluted. And it sounds to me from what you're saying that those two software and developer, they're not really capable of doing that to that level, which is probably a risk as well. Is that the case?
So what we have tried to do is, so we close the accounts, we do the statement on a project management basis, so we do involve all the finance teams, just because of the extent of the additional transactions that we've had to put through this year, because some of the quite new technical requirements that CIPA have put requirements on us to do. We do have one specialist in that area who's unfortunately absent. There are other members of the team who are able to do that, but with the two vacancies that we're holding and the other two members and staff that are actually on, this is kind of one of the reasons why we've encountered some difficulties in this area. As I say, as a result of the restructure, we are putting more capacity in place, and the way that we do the accounts for next year will be on a completely different basis. So because of the restructure, the job descriptions have been changed. Staff are much more generic in nature now, they are able to cut across and flexible across each other's areas. So there won't be a single point of failure, so a lot more of the team will be able to do a lot more of the work, and we're making sure that we put that in place from when the restructure starts, which will probably be hopefully in August, if not early September, to make sure that we've got all these vacancies in place. So if we do have capacity issues, if there are vacancies, if members and staff do go off sick next year, there'll be more people to be able to.
To be honest, I was still struggling to think with four people missing out of the team, 40, me from Karl, to the accounts, notwithstanding our bit. I'm not talking about Grant Thornton's bit, or even the bit that, this one had, but just the other bits of it.
Specialists.
Well, I'm sure we've still got a chief accountant. It depends on who the specialist is and what they're being asked to do. So, I'm presuming when we get the accounts, we will get a report, because maybe people relatively knew that we were restructuring the finance department, and there was this problem, there was all these sort of segregation of jobs, and we weren't flexible, and that meant we were likely to not to hit our legal requirements of getting our finances out by the 30th. Did everyone know about that before?
circumstances that the officers have actually been there. I'm just wondering to help me on that. Because there's no space in the agenda for agent business.
It is always the discretion of the chair to re-urge the business. And I think it is a sense of committee that these issues were on the accounts.
Yeah, I think that's the point. As long as there should have been the accounts on the agenda, I don't know here. I would try to find out why. And we as we're finding out why and appeal about the other issues have emerged that have needed to be picked up. I actually thought that discussion was quite, I think, but I'm a bit sad. I found it quite valuable. I think other colleagues came and Adrian also found it quite useful to find out there was this issue that no one else seemed to know about before. And we'd like to know what's being done to stop it happening again. And to find out how many other legal requirements we're not making. I thought that was quite a useful discussion, did you, Mr. Chair?
It's a time and place, but we spent 15 minutes on our major agenda. And we've not just been sort of the council being in multiple subjects. So I just think access to discussion should be on the agenda, should be more published, and give everyone the chance to be there.
I couldn't agree more with you, Stu. I think we should have had the quarterly budgets monitoring report, and we should have had the annual accounts, and we didn't. So we've had a discussion about that. Okay, go on, Adrian. So, okay, just for Stuart then, are we all okay with that as an issue? We've picked up as by Colin that we were entitled to do it. Sure. It was my approval, which I give, and I was about to move on to the proper agenda. Go on.
Agenda items that should
Well, but well done on that one, actually. I think that's going to make a big difference. Thank you for that. Right, item five, again, says Chief Internal Auditor.
Thank you, Chair. As the Chief Internal Auditor for the Council, I'm mandated required to prepare and present an annual report for some items of work undertaken by
the Council. And you did it. You did it.
It's with you as we speak.
That's what it's not like.
The purpose of the report is to provide you with an opinion as to the effectiveness of the assurance payments that we've evaluated throughout the year. The report that you have before you is presented in the standards designed to comply with not quite exacting the requirements of the book, second internal standards. It's very comprehensive. It has to be comprehensive to ensure that all of those 300 plus requirements are addressed within the report. The template we've used is a template that's been provided and produced by the public sector in terms of standards. So whilst it is comprehensive, I acknowledge and appreciate that, but it has to be presented in the way that it is. The opinion identified in the report reflects all the work conducted by the internal audit service during the full 2018-19 period up to the 31st of March 2019. It acknowledges the steps that have been taken within the organisation during that year and in the year to implement more effective control and governance arrangements across the council. The opinion is identified at 10.2 on page 21 is not too dissimilar from the opinion provided previously this time last year. It does acknowledge that there are issues that require further work by the organisation. It acknowledges some of the good work that's been done by the organisation to improve some of the control of those arrangements. The opinion does also acknowledge that there are still, as I mentioned, some weaknesses in the system that do require attention. The achievement of the objectives are not being processed by these. Details of this are included within the report of Section 3 and 4. The opinion is based on an assessment of the governance arrangements that we looked at, an assessment of the risk management arrangements and the framework for risk management of the provision. The outcome of our risk based assignments and developments throughout the year that we were aware of. Comments provided within the report of Sections 3 and 4, pages 27 and 42 respectively, for each of those areas that have identified progress made during the year to make improvements. You can.
No, I'm just trying to track through. Okay. You mentioned numbers and you tend to fly through them.
I give the committee paper numbers.
Committee paper numbers, not the government report numbers.
I've fallen foul of past the providing of the report numbers.
Okay.
I've got maps in any number, so it's the committee paper.
We are very easily bubbled. Can we just hold you for a second?
You can
talk about your overall opinion. So your overall opinion appears on page 21.
That's correct.
Where it says, my overall opinion is that.
That's
So, before we delve into some of the reasons for that you're going to pick up, I personally am concerned when we say we have weaknesses in the design of inconsistent application. And that's putting the achievement of
oversight of all of the actions that emanated from those reports, of individual reports. We've also had the ability in the year to ensure that the relevant officers have been actioning all of the recommendations that arose from within those reports.
I'm sure others will want to comment and see if hands flying around. But can I just pick up, because I understand this backlog report, and we have seen the individual reports that come up. What this is doing, I think, is asking you for your opinion, and you are giving your opinion, that you still think, because you say, however, some weaknesses in the design of existing application control may have been issued. You didn't say could have, it said may, so be more forward-looking. So from your experience, what happened last year, what's your concern going forward? And I think my question, which you didn't quite answer, was, has this been brought to the attention of the Chief Executive? And what is he intending to do about it? Has he given you, have you had a conversation? Is he going to write to us? What, because I would imagine we're all quite concerned on it when you see something like that.
What I would say to you is that, I was getting round to it.
Oh, right, okay.
What I would say is that the actual actions that arose from the report, as I say, have either been addressed or they're in the process of being addressed. So whilst there are issues as we move out of 2019 into 2020, some of those issues like them remain on the table and will be subject of various follow-up work which you will be on the receiving end of the outcomes of. The information goodness is wanted to give you an idea. There's a work on the plan that is required. There's some work that we're undertaking among the financial leaders of the organisation as well. Again, it's the outcome of that will inform yourselves. But this is all work that, there's nothing there that remains outstanding at this precise moment. At the moment, like Manette, everything is being actioned in the way that we'd like, in line with the timescales that we've laid down for the implementation of the Act. And you will be not receiving any reports that provide you with regular updates on those. Not just through the committees that we have here, but through the final reports that I sent to you back out, which provide again you with an opportunity to.
When you say that to you, we'll look at the committee.
Everybody gets a copy of that. And it's emailed to you directly on a 2 week basis for timely purposes, because I'm acknowledging the fact that we only meet on a quarterly basis. Sometimes you can get a lot on that. You get those final reports that say 2 week basis, and we'll identify exactly the nature of the work that was undertaken. There'll be a description of the actual audits, there'll be an identification of the actual actions, and there'll be a brand rating, or a rank rating that clearly indicates whether it's a fair down or a green.
And that's all super. And the Chief Executive said?
The Chief Executive is comfortable with the fact that the actions that we've agreed with all the Chief Officers are in the process of being implemented, either have been implemented I meet with them on a regular bi-monthly basis, and if there's something that might be de-escalated to him, I do so, and he will take appropriate action in relation to him. He remains outstanding with the relevant chief officer. It also gets discussed, as I say, at the senior leadership team, and similar kind of conversations take place around that table in relation to any that remains outstanding. So, in the same way that this committee, throughout the year, had the opportunity. dive report later on the agenda, and I know we'll provide a little bit more detail in relation to what mitigation is currently taking place in relation to the financial things. Full breakdown of all the opinions provided for internal audit reports undertaken during the years included section 4 on page 42. The section includes an explanation of the risk of being provided in audit reports and runs in a grade from negligible.
I could just have a little bit of a break. Cathy, you were going to ask for reference one, weren't you?
Yeah, looking at the chart for 2017,
18, 19. I'll give everyone a shout on the
page. Major has gone from 4% to 7%, it's nearly double. And negligible has gone down from 17 to 11. Presumably, I think, possibly, that negligible went from not negligible to moderate or minor, but jumped from negligible to major. So the point I'd like to make is, if we have these different categories between negligible, minor, moderate, and then major, what have we got in place that makes sure that something goes from negligible? Well, should something go from negligible to major when you've got moderate and minor in between? Because one of the ones, the one you were pointing out, the major one, transactional management, client finance support unit, you said that only one of the assignments resulted in a major organisational audit opinion being provided. And this concerned work undertaken within the client finance support unit, which I'm not sure what that is. When following the transfer of the unit to customer services, a number of significant risks were identified by the business unit management team in respect to quota protection and direct payments. A working group was formed by the Director of Finance and Investment during the year and is currently actively addressing identified issues in a timely manner. Internal audit are providing advice and support to this group and will continue to do so until an effective control environment has been implemented and tested. So what I was going to ask was, what specifically, in terms of the quota protection direct payments, are we talking about when we're looking at something that is a major problem? And it's still going on. And in terms of, this is overpayments to people, and if it's major, because first it's on the committee, I'm not sure where I would determine something to be negligible, moderate, minor, major. That's what you do. So if something's major and there's only one, it must be almost a sort of a Chernobyl moment sort of thing. You know, we get to major. But on the graph,
transfer from where it was previously located and a lack of involvement, lack of cap, senior management oversight of that unit and the work of that unit. And there were established procedures in place that clearly it would have been a benefit. We looked at this 3 years ago and the government produced a report that had in the region of some 30 recommendations. Those actions, when it sat previously with the adults, were addressed at that time, but over a period of time, the management of that unit, when I was within adults, also those reports as it was actually to appear. Some of those recommendations were clearly voted on over a period of time due to staffing flows, due to various other actions. chair is saying,